Hello and welcome to the edition of the C-Squared Podcast. Your host, Curtis, with my co-host, Aaliyah. And today we are here with the vocalist of Hi-Rez, Britta. And she's going to be talking to us for the next 30 or 40 minutes about her time in the band and about her vocal coaching and a bunch of other different things. So it's going to be a pretty darn fun podcast, I think. So to start off, first of all, thank you for joining us.
Oh, thank you for having me. It's a pleasure. I got to know your podcast, and I'm really like curious to dive in deeper. Like, you're doing a great job there.
Thank you very much. So to start off the questions, we're going to start off with an interesting one. So what was the soundtrack of your childhood?
Oh, that's a really interesting question, because I think I have two soundtracks of my childhood. One is like probably a very ordinary childhood thing that I listened to a lot of kids' tunes when I was younger. And of course, I had all my, we have like a bunch of kids' plays that we listened to on cassettes back in the 80s. So that was just the typical thing. And then on the other hand, like, I have a brother who is 10 years older than I am. And for a very long time, up until I was like 5 or 6, like, we shared a room together. So he was in his teenage years and I was like very young. So I grew up like to Iron Maiden, AC/DC tunes mixed together with my childhood la-la-las. So that's awesome. Kind
that
of...
That makes a lot of sense. That's cool.
You kind of answered the next question already, sort of. But if you could get into a little bit more detail, like, how did you get into metal in general?
Well, I first got in touch with metal through my older brother. I don't think that it kind of like got me into metal, but the entrance was made already. It was already introduced to me. So even though only many of my male friends listened to metal, like, I have always been a metalhead, even though I had different phases of like a really, really long goth phase, and like, I had my punk phase and whatnot, but metal was always there. Like, it never left my side. So yeah.
I have a follow-up question to that, but what was your first metal album that you actually owned, out of curiosity?
My first like real metal, my brother gave me a Europe vinyl for my, I think, 8th birthday, but I'm not sure that counts as metal.
Sure, it does. So sure,
it does. Europe is metal. I'm not sure.
They got some heavy stuff. They got some really heavy stuff at times. Yeah, I like Europe. Anyway, sorry.
The first one I bought myself was Metallica. I think it was Metallica. Which one was it? Was it Ride the Lightning first? I think Ride the Lightning was my first album that I paid by myself, cool. That I bought.
What format was it, out of curiosity?
It was on CD.
CD? Cool. Okay, I've done my follow-up, Aaliyah.
Cool. Now, Britta, your vocals are so diverse, and you've been doing it for like almost 20 years. And I was listening to some of your other interviews, and I heard your explanation of different writing styles, because you're in like a more old school death metal band in Critical Mess, and Hi-Rez is more melodic death metal. And you gave a great explanation about how the writing styles are different for the two genres. Can you give us a little detail about that?
Yeah, I'm not so sure about like writing, but as far as I think you want to dive into like how I place the vocals within the music, because I feel like that's a really, really different scenario. Yeah. Well, the way I look at it is like, depending on which genre of music you're making as a vocalist, you have to find your spot in the orchestration of the music. Like, there are so many different styles of singing that, or singing approaches that you can bring to a band, be like very melodic or be like very punchy, going into rap where it almost covers all the instruments, like, you know what I mean? So between melodic death metal and like the more old school death metal, I would say that I'm probably more on the guitar side when it comes to how I place my vocals and how I phrase my sentences in Hi-Rez. So it's more melodic, and it's somewhere maybe even with the guitar. So when there's a solo, I'm not singing, of course, but like in the verses and stuff like that, like where it's like mostly rhythms, I take over the lead position for this part. in contrast, like to the old school death metal, I would say I am more between guitars and bass and drums. So I use my vocals almost more like a percussive instrument, where I am much more punchier. I have less melodies, and I do not take over lead too much because I leave that to the guitars. So like, yeah, it's a kind of different approach how you think of yourself as a vocalist. I could not switch that with these both bands because it would just destroy the music and go against it.
Yeah, and you were in a thrash band. Do you think that was the placement for that a little different than those two, or was it kind of comparable to one or the other?
I would say in thrash metal, the way my thrash metal band was playing music, it was probably right in the middle. So I think at High Res and Critical Mess, when you combine these two styles, somewhere like my former band Cripper was somewhere in the middle, I would say, where I could take over lead if I wanted to, but I could always just like go with a punch as well.
So interesting, because even though they have like the same instruments going on, the dynamic is so different, and you really accentuate that with the vocal style.
Yes, it is. And it's like so cool. Like some people that who don't listen to metal at all, that they think like, well, that's just metal, or like maybe four or five different genres of metal, but like there's so much to learn. You can really nerd into that stuff if you're really up to it.
For sure. And speaking of nerding into things, you have a whole course about screaming vocals mastery up on ProMix Academy. And I wondered, what was your mission when you were putting that together, or who were you writing it for?
I don't know, like for the longest time, I didn't want to do a course like that. I mean, I'm self-employed and I make most of my money with screaming and teaching other people how to scream, growl and shout. So I always tell everyone I have the best job in the world. I yell at my customers, they yell back, they are happy, I get paid. So that's for that. Many people have asked me, do you have anything online? Do you have any course that we can do at home? And I was always like, well, there's so much good stuff out there already. Why do I have to add to that? Because on the other hand, like so many of my students come to me because they say, like, I can't work with tutorials that are online because I don't get a feedback on my vocals. So like, it's a kind of like, two wishes that are opposite to each other. But then again, I thought like, why not just like melt my knowledge into an online course and see if it can spark interest in people to dive into that? Because sometimes maybe people are hesitant to book one-on-one lessons because they don't know what to expect. And I think a course like that maybe gives you an overview how much there is actually to discover, and maybe also that it is not just screaming and that there is more to it, and that it's a fun instrument. So I think for those people who are interested and just want to, like, you know, try out a little bit for themselves before they come into a lesson with me or with someone else, that might be a good idea.
Yeah, I think I'm kind of like that. I don't like going to a lesson before I kind of have some kind of grasp of what I'm doing. But so it's nice to have the options out there for different types of people and what they're comfortable with.
Yeah, exactly. And also, like, the platform is super professional, and I like all the people that I work with, and it was just a fun experience and a new experience. So it was good.
I have to interject a question that I had mentioned this to Aaliyah before, and pardon if this is a dumb question, because I know nothing about singing. I'm not a singer or anything like that. So could you basically teach anyone, like, let's say someone doesn't, like, what do you have to do in order to be able to teach someone effectively to be able to scream or sing or something? What is necessary?
I think two things are really necessary. One is that as a teacher, I try to paint a correct anatomical picture of what is going on inside your throat and in your body, mm-hmm. and what parts have to work together in order to produce sounds like that. Because many people have are under the impression that you have to, I don't know, forcefully grind things together, that it feels as harsh as it sounds. which is definitely not the case. So I'm not swallowing nails and drinking child blood in the morning. Demystifying metal again. So that's on the one hand, like where you have need to have the correct picture. We don't see our instrument that is unique to the instrument voice. And on the other hand, I try to explain to people that my job as a vocal coach for the most part is to get rid of the unnecessary things people do when they scream. I also mentioned that in my course, like it's like you have 50 things that you do to scream and you only need two of that. So let's get rid of the 48 things that get in the way. So you have to be willing to trust the process a little bit, sound very weird in the beginning, and just move along and trust your own voice and trust in finding your own voice. That's probably more like a mindset that you need to bring. And the rest is simply practice. I mean, we've all done our first scream when we came to this earth, because our birth scream is what we do on stage, basically. And then society comes and tells you to be quiet. So, yeah.
So do you think you have to have talent, though, in order to be able to do that? Like, or does it not really matter?
It matters to a certain point. To be quite honest, like I have no idea what talent actually is. More I think about it, it's more and more a mystery to me. I think what you need to have is a certain connection with your body. So when some people don't even know when they breathe in or when they exhale, some people are not aware of the difference. And so when you start with that, you have to build a connection with your body. And the better your connection with your own body is, the better you can feel and pinpoint the all the places where you feel vibration, where you feel where it's dry, where you feel where it's too tight in order to get rid of that. So I would say this is the talent that you need to have, that you need to bring or build up. And the rest, I would say, is consistency, also being patient, finding the right purpose for your voice as well. So like if you want to try to sound like someone else, I can tell you that won't work. It's like being comfortable in your own skin, like seeing yourself in the mirror and said, okay, I'm okay the way I am. Yeah. It's the same with the voice. Like you have to find your comfort with that.
So I guess not everybody could become a professional even with practice. Well, I mean, they could with practice, you're saying, but they would have to like actually want it and be prepared to do the work is what you're saying.
Yes. And I mean, professional is a big word. Professional means that you make your money with it. And that comes with songwriting.
True.
So like,
true. That's a good point.
So I think that you can become a very well skilled screamer or growler by practicing a lot and by paying attention to where your voice is leading you. That I'm sure that I have, let's phrase it like, I have not met a person who could not learn.
That's basically what I wanted to find out. Yeah. So yeah. I got one more follow-up before we get back on track. I'm really sorry, Aaliyah, but so is there a difference between teaching someone, or what is the difference rather between teaching someone to scream versus sing, and is one easier than the other? And again, I'm sorry if these are dumb questions. I really don't know these.
That's a really tricky question because as far as teaching, I would say both are equally difficult to do, simply for the fact that every voice is unique to each person. I cannot exchange an instrument with the students as I could with a guitar or even with a flute or whatever. Like I cannot pick it and show, and I cannot tell relax the hand, palm mute farther back. I cannot do that because like I need metaphors, I need explanations that I experience myself.
Yeah.
And I need to hope that the other person translates that into their own experience. So you have to be very good in finding different perspectives for explanation, and to just kind of get a feeling for the student and how their thought process is running. So I would say that's the same. The difference between teaching someone how to scream and teaching someone how to sing is that the screaming in pop culture which is also metal, screaming in pop culture, popular mm-hmm. culture, yeah. Is rather new compared to, for example, classical singing. So we do not have the big book of metal vocals that tells us this is the word for this technique and mm-hmm. this is the word for this technique. So there's a lot of vocabulary out there that it's used in for so many different things, and so many people are confused by that. So you have to establish a language with your student. So mm-hmm. when I say this, I mean that. I don't have no idea what the other person is meaning by that, but just so that you can establish the vocabulary with your student, you cannot open the book and say it's that.
Wow. Okay. Aliyah, I'll let you get us back on track.
No, I mean, and I think that's the comment about the metaphors is so true. Like sometimes I'll listen in to people's streams, like Adrienne Cowan from Seven Spires, and she'll relay some stuff that she heard from her voice teacher about oranges in the rib cage or something like that. And I'm just like, oh yes, that makes sense. The metaphors are really like powerful, but yeah, you have to find them. So I wanted to also ask about your studio recommendations. Like you mentioned, when you go into the studio, you actually tend to get your takes like in one or two takes. How do you manage to do that? And why is that important for a vocalist as opposed to for another musician?
I'm not sure I understood what you mean. One or two takes, like on what? Like
for like just really getting your vocals down in the studio for your recording. Like you get them quickly because you've prepared beforehand.
Mm-hmm. Well, I prepare a lot before I go into the studio, but it takes me a very long time to lay down vocals. I'm so slow in the studio because I'm so overly picky when it comes to that. So I don't have like one or two takes for one vocal line. I probably have 10 or 11.
My misunderstanding.
So, yeah, no, sorry. That's okay. So what I do is I layer like three tracks, and I always give like three tracks of the same line into the studio, and I let the mixer and producer pick how much of that does he or she want to put into the song, and give like how to texturize the vocals with the rest of the instruments. So I leave that up to them. But other than that, the preparation for the studio is really important for a vocalist to be able to sing with the least effort possible. And this is like, if you don't know how to phrase a sentence, you need way more than just 10 takes until you're happy with the sound. You need like, do I phrase it like this? Do I sing it double time? And like, what's the rhythm? It's just like a tiring process. And the creative process, I feel, needs to be done before you enter a studio.
Right. That was what I thought I heard you mentioning before that I wanted to get into, because I do feel like that's something other instrumentalists have a little more flexibility with. They can play around with that a little bit, but the voice is limited and it gets fatigued. And so, you can't push it like other musicians can.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, like for a death metal drummer, probably that doesn't count because like they are done after a few hours as well, because it's just metal sports what we're doing. But yeah, that's true. Like, I mean, I can do 5 hours in a studio easily. But then I would need like a day of vocal rest, just simply because I can still perform and sing, and I'm not like, I don't have anything bad going on with my voice, but it's tired, and I probably am not at 110% how I want to be in the studio. I'm probably only like at 99%, and I hear that, and I need to live with the product that I'm doing.
Yeah. What was the recording process for recording the new album from High Res from 2021?
Lonely. It was in the pandemic. We didn't even meet for writing, so we had Zoom calls and we sent files and everything. And I am really, really happy that every musician at Hi-Res is an experienced musician, so we all know how to record and even like pre-edit our stuff and to get it ready for the studio. So that's a big advantage. Otherwise, we would not have been able to like make a record and to produce it. So, but hire as being a new band, and to not really having a feel for all the songs and to not even having them played in the rehearsal room, it was a very unique experience. It was unique and it was a good experience, but I don't want to necessarily do that again that way. It was like, I was, you know, we all were like kind of like, I don't know, like lonelier than usually during the pandemic. And then it was like middle of the winter, it was very dark outside, sitting alone in my rehearsal room, writing all the stuff and screaming my butt off, like in the middle of the night. And it's just like, what am I doing? I mean, I'm really happy to be an artist who was able to be creative in the pandemic, because I feel like it leaves a footprint of the experience of being in such a global event in the music without necessarily writing about it, you know, but the feeling, the emotion is imprinted in that album. And we will see how we can hear that when the next record follows. Will it sound differently? I don't know.
Yeah, I'm really curious to hear. It is a really great album, and being melodic death metal, that kind of sad, forlorn emotion, it fits the genre very well, I think.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So I kind of want to go off topic, Aaliyah, if possible.
Move, go ahead.
Cool. So basically, I just kind of want to ask you, since you brought up the pandemic, how was it for getting students during the pandemic, out of curiosity? Like, how did that work with your coaching and
it
stuff?
It skyrocketed. Like, wow, it was okay. Such a business accelerator because everyone was in home office.
Fair.
So, like, it's... Since I'm teaching screams and growls only, like I'm in sort of a niche, but there is a high demand. And I don't know how many vocal teachers are out there for screaming, but like, let's say it's like 15 or 20 that I know of.
Yeah, not a lot.
Yeah, and there are at least like 200 vocal coaches for clean vocals in my hometown. So like, we're looking at a lot of people who want to do that. And I have students from many different countries and continents. So for the most part, I'm teaching online anyway. And I also do workshops, which I could not do because they are face to face. But everyone was in home office. And so I don't teach at long hours in the night because of neighbors and because I need my free time as well. Mm-hmm. So everyone was at home, and I was teaching basically from morning 9 a.m. on to 6 o'clock at night, screaming and yelling. And
so I kind of also wanted to know, like, if you're willing to talk about, like, so what's the process to get someone to work with you for as a student? Like, do you go through a routine to make sure they qualify in some way, like they're good enough or anything? Like, what happens if, like, I reached out to you and said, teach me how to scream?
Well, the first thing that you need to be prepared to be is that patient, because I have so many students that I can't take on any more students at the moment.
But if
so
you did.
I need people. If you did, it's very easy. We just like, we speak, for example, on Instagram or whichever medium you reach out to me. And then we just agree on a first lesson. We do the lesson. And then later we decide if we feel it's a good fit. I mean, I don't want to compare myself to a doctor, but mm-hmm. I feel like it's like you have to establish or that you have a feeling for the person. And if that feeling is not there, which can happen, people quickly move on, or like I say, well, I'm not sure that this is a good teacher-student connection. So I would recommend you maybe talk to him or her. These are like colleagues of mine, and maybe you get what you find there. But that's the process. Like, I don't do any. I don't take on students that are good or that are exactly not good or beginners or like. I have like so many different people who come to me with so many different approaches. Some even don't want to be metal vocalists. Some just want to find this kind of vocals for them and in them. And it gives them something else that they are looking for. So there's really all ages from 14 to, I think my oldest student was 79 when she started.
Wow.
And yeah, that's like people of all kinds, and it's wonderful.
Okay, I got one more follow-up on that. I know we don't have a ton of time left, and Aaliyah's probably wanting to ask a few more things, but so what do you do, like, if the person comes to you for the first lesson and you can just tell it's not going to work out? Like, how do you kind of, but they really want to be a screamer, but you can just tell it's not going to happen. Like, what do you do in that type of a case?
Well, it depends on the reason. I had one student approaching me. He wanted me to tell him how to scream, and he expected me to explain it in a way that he could do it right after that.
No way.
And I'm like, well, like, this is like the expectation that I cannot fulfill, because like, it depends on your schedule. And he didn't want to put in the work.
Yeah.
And he said, I would not be a good teacher if I couldn't come up with that. And I'm like, okay, then maybe I'm not, and you need to find someone else. So I spoke like that. And then sometimes when, like, it usually it's not after first lesson, but when it happens, it's like after 10 or 12 lessons, I don't do any contracts with my students.
Oh,
because
okay.
I think people who stay because of a contract don't have a fun learning experience. And yeah. I don't want to raise the expectation that they need to stay with me. I've made the experience with my vocal teachers many times that I didn't want to go on, but I had paid in advance for like a year, so I stayed. And it was just an overall bad experience. And so like you get a feeling for that when people don't practice anymore, when they just overall lose interest.
Yeah.
I just have an open word with them. And like, is this the right thing that you want to do? And then they just spill the beans and say like, no, man, maybe it's not, or like, I want to focus on something else. And then that's cool. But for the most part, students stay. And for the most part, it's like, I don't know. I love my students. I have so much love for my students, and I'm always like seeing their progresses and going through all the ups and downs.
I think that's a smart way of doing
it. I have the best world job in the world. What?
I like the way you're doing that, because like my kids, my daughter wanted to do dancing at one point, and we paid for her for like a year. And then it was like after four lessons, she didn't want to do it, but we kind of felt like she had to do it, because it was paid in advance. But the way you're saying it actually makes a lot of sense, because it doesn't force the person to continue if they realize it's not a good fit for them. So I just wanted to mention, I really like that you did that.
And also, I mean, if I can add something to that, it's like people, I always thought it was a German thing that you start something, you finish it. And I'm like, why? Like, how can you know that something is right for you when you don't try it? Like, I mean, like I've tried so many things in my childhood. My parents let me start and change everything like so many times, and I'm so grateful for that. Like, I when I didn't want to go, I didn't have to go, and this has led me to doing things I love rather than feeling the obligation to fulfill something that I don't want to do.
Fair. I got one last follow up question for myself, Ali, and then I'll let you. Go with whatever the heck that you want to do here. Might even be two. But basically, I just wanted to kind of find out. So like, what is a reasonable expectation of time for you to train someone then? Because you mentioned about the guy wanting to know instantly. So what would be expectation wise? Year, 2 years, few months? Like, I don't know. I'm curious now that you mention it.
It depends. I'm beginning to see, like with so many students that I've had, that the mindset and also setting yourself goals is very important, probably like in sports. Yeah. When you come once a week or every 2 weeks or once a month, like depending on whatever schedule you're on, and you have a purpose, like say, I have this band now, I don't know what I'm doing, please teach me, then it's a very fast learning, very steep learning curve. If you don't have that purpose, and you're kind of just like doing it because you could also play chess online with someone else, but you're singing, then you won't make the progress. But for someone who has no prior knowledge in screaming and growling and is like seriously diving into it, I would say that for like the more simpler techniques, give it like 4 months before they probably can sing a song, or maybe even three songs without dropping the ball, so to say. And for the more advanced techniques and the more difficult techniques, I would say maybe just like something close to a year before it's can be seen as an artistic tool.
So what kind of a schedule is that though? I don't think you said the schedule on that. So if you were doing like a year to get to that point, newbie, what would you need to do in terms of the schedule?
Well, first off, you don't need any lessons at all. You can do all that by yourself, like so many other people did. So I don't want to advertise getting lessons here.
No, that's fine. I'm just curious.
Getting lessons is probably just a way to erase errors up front that you don't have to unlearn later in your singing career. So what I would say, if you train like 3 or 4 times a week, in the beginning, maybe just 15 minutes per training day, and you do all the other exercises, especially for breathing, for posture, for pronunciation, for hearing. Hearing is such a big part of learning how to sing, and it often is forgotten. When you do all that, you can really build a good connection with your voice, find out where your limitations are and work around that, and just teach yourself how to teach yourself. You know, teach yourself how to make your own process and how to overcome obstacles. So, and this is like before you can run off into your life, I would say, if you are a very, very eager student, you can easily do that in a year. That's no problem.
Yeah, that doesn't sound like much of a schedule at all that you have to do. It's pretty easy in terms of time commitment. I guess it's just the mindset, like you said. So interesting.
Well, yes. Your overall ability to focus on going slow and not overdoing.
Yep. Okay, cool. I'm done on my end, Aaliyah.
Yeah, it's very easy for vocalists, I think, to get a little excited and overdo it. And then they need to take vocal rest. And then their body slows them down if they can't do it themselves. You mentioned doing exercises, and if you're willing to go into like what are some of the best exercises that you find help prepare you for performance or just getting in the right space for vocals.
Mm-hmm. So I encourage my students to find a mantra for them, a mantra that with the purpose of bringing breathing and body motion together. I have no experience in yoga, but there's one exercise, it's called 8 motions of the spine that I do before I go on stage, before I practice, before I do anything. And it's basically just like 8 motions in a certain way, in a certain order that you do. Where you inhale and exhale together with the body motion. And when you do that many times, it can become a great tool to, you know, take off the jacket of your ordinary life with all your problems, with everything that has happened to you on that specific day or time, and just leave it there so that your overall body tension can handle singing. Because when you're too tight, when you're too loose, when you're too whatever, like you have to be like in a sort of flow moment with your body and to be able to perform properly and to sing in a healthy way. So that's what I'm doing to escape that problematic shell that surrounds us all. And then of course, establish a proper warm-up that is very specific for your own needs. You have to find that. I can introduce a million warm-up tweaks and tools for the student, but they have to find what's working for them. It's very unique. And some people need 5 minutes, some people need half an hour. It really depends. So, and then I cannot stress that enough. The vocal health, especially of a metal vocalist who has to work with excess pressure when it comes to air pressure. The health comes from how well you can handle your breathing and your diaphragm. And many people have a wrong idea of how the diaphragm actually works, because like many people think when they flex their abdominal muscles, like in a sit-up motion, that they can press the diaphragm and press the air out. But this is not working at all, because the diaphragm relaxes into the exhaling process. And it's tension on the inhaling process. And because it's a muscle that we don't have control over, like we have control over our arm muscle, we try to, you know, press the air out in a sit-up motion. But the best way I can describe is that look at people who sing opera. You will not find a single operatic singer who at the end of the long aria tone is like curled up in a ball on stage. They are all like getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger the longer they hold the note. And this is because they open their rib cage into the tone rather than closing their rib cage in the tone. And this is something that many people are not used to, or maybe haven't learned precise enough. And I stress that a lot. Work on your breathing and just like get it into your muscle memory so that you don't have to focus on that when you sing. No one can focus on like this and this and this and this. When you sing, you want to focus on the performance, the emotion, having a good time. So this is something that your body needs to understand and learn. And then from that on, it's a smoother sailing, so to say.
So we're running out of time, but I know Aaliyah had a question about the fitness question, if you want to ask that, because I was curious about that, Aaliyah.
Oh, well, I mean, because breathing is so important to singing, I was wondering if do you find that like a traditional workout is beneficial, lifting versus cardio? Is there any of that like more generic stuff that applies still to vocals?
Mm-hmm. Well, for me, I would say that an overall healthy and fit body is necessary for singing in a healthy way and sustain your vocal health. So smoking, drinking a lot of alcohol and stuff like that, that's like a myth that it's like it's probably getting you a raspy voice in an unhealthy way. Mm-hmm. And singing for a long period, let's say on a tour, every night 1 hour, and you're touring 3 weeks, you need more the fitness of a marathon runner than the fitness of a bodybuilder. However, when you have a good body feeling through whatever sports you're doing, you will always feel like more comfort when you sing. I cannot do ab muscle workout the day before I sing, because then my body tenses too easy in that position. And that kind of takes away the fine tuning that I need for my breathing support. So what I really focus on building up is just my back muscles need to be able to carry my weight without hunching over all the time. And since I'm sitting a lot, I need to work on my posture, and that helps me with my breathing. But yeah, an overall healthy body is fit body is really good when you have your instrument in your body.
Great advice. I guess I'll wrap up with a final question. I took a look at your Instagram and I saw some pictures of you on your motorcycle. So mm-hmm. What is the greater thrill, performing live or riding your bike?
Ooh, the greater thrill. I don't think that riding my bike feels like a thrill. So I would say performing live is a thrill. Because I feel like I want to know what I expect when I lean into a curve, and I don't want to know what to expect when I go on a show. So I like Fair surprises enough. In my shows, but I don't like surprises when I'm on my motorcycle. So I ride my motorcycle to clear my head, like to just be in the moment and to just let it roll. Like I'm a cruiser, I'm not a racer, so I don't have the adrenaline rush that other people seek in motorcycle riding. I'm just more like sitting, watching, you know, taking it easy on the road. So, nice. And I feel much more adrenaline and excitement when it comes to live performing. Yes.
Awesome. With that, thank you so much for coming on. We're going to wrap things up. Everyone listening, I hope that this episode helped you. and that you can find something in it that will augment your musical performance and writing. And thank you so much for listening. Until next time, make like a bull and throw those horns up.